If you are like me and end up prototyping on a breadboard where your components end up being loose and making it very difficult to troubleshoot, take your projects or your prototyping to the next level by going to PCBWay and getting a proper PCB manufactured for your prototyping or your next project. Simply head over to the PCBWay website and click on Instant Quote, and there you can provide the specifications and the requirements for your project and simply place your order.
Hello YouTubers, and welcome to this perhaps rather unusual kind of video. I call it a vlog. It's going to be a vlog. You're not going to see anything of real interest on my bench or anything. I'm just going to chat about perhaps a little frustration that came to me today, because I wanted to produce a video on testing noise, but last night I'd finished building my mirrored enclosure to test solar panels, and that's on the floor taking up space. I thought, well, let me jump into that and get that done. And I'm thinking, well, now I'm changing the order. And all these silly frustrations kind of popped into my head. And I just didn't know what video to do. And I just thought I'd do a video on a bit of background in terms of, again, the way I kind of manage projects and how to keep people's attention on watching a video, which perhaps you will have realized trying to keep people's attention is not one of the top of my priorities. And I'll explain why. So, the first thing I'll explain, one distraction I have in my life, which has come into my life in the past 6 months, is a little Havanese hound, which spends the day with me in the cabin. So it's just one of those other little challenges I have to deal with. We got this little pooch about 6 months ago. She's a year old now. She's the runt of the pack. So she's a little small. She's my daughter's puppy, but she spends the day with me because obviously she's doing online school. So in theory, one would have thought she could be at home with my daughter, but of course her being on camera and having to attend classes, that's a challenge. Charlotte, come here, come. Let's show who you are. Come here. Good girl. Right. So this poor little hound, which I've got in my hands, Charlotte. She is just over a year old now. She often sits or lies down. I try and find a point where she doesn't need distracting, because she often wants to play and be entertained. She will nap, if I'm lucky, for maybe an hour, hour and a half. She'll relax and what have you. But often she'll be sitting there, and then when she wants attention, she'll start to growl at me. She'll go, "Rrr." And so then we have a little back and forth. I have to stop filming or I have to tell her to keep quiet. But this is the little distraction that sits in the cabin at the moment. So I'm going to try and put it down on the bed. If not, I may in fact have to have it on my lap. We'll see. Let me just put it down quickly. Good girl. And you might be in for a little laugh, because I think she might start a little game where she starts growling. But anyway, okay, so let me just explain the thing about projects, and then the interesting thing that I learned about keeping people's attention to watch videos. Now, I bet you this video is going to get very low views in comparison to my other videos. Often my other videos, a mediocre video is going to get now between 1.5 and maybe just about 2,000 views. A reasonable view count, if I do something interesting or which is going to perhaps capture a broader part of the audience, like something on my Nissan Leaf, maybe 5,000. Gone are the days where I'm going to get tens of thousands or even several million views. I have videos with several million views on them. But I've kind of reached the point where I'm not bothered by that. I used to kind of be tied up in the numbers game of YouTube. And in July I turned 50, so perhaps at my age now I'm kind of like, I'm past that. But I thought I'd just chat about this one, about how interesting it is. A lesson I learned when I was in Standard 4 in South Africa. Now again, so I'm going off the track. Let me, before I even talk about this lesson about being distracted and trying to hold people's attention to the camera, because people will have, I can tell you now, this will get low views, and within the first minute or two, a lot of people will have dropped out, right? Because this is not really good directed chit chat to a point, and that drives people insane. Now they want the entertainment here and now, so, and to keep their attention. But anyway, so I have a whole ream of projects, and the one challenge is that perhaps in the past, quite a few years ago, I found that I could start a project and do multiple parts or multiple videos on that same project, and you'd be taking your audience along the way for the most part. Often people perhaps might get distracted and not want to continue watching that project, but for the most part, you could go have a multi-part video, 5, even 10 parts, and follow them up in reasonably close succession, and people would follow it along. But I found that as years have progressed, and people are distracted with their cell phones or their tablets, or what I'm going to talk about, I say, when I learned this back when I was in Standard 4, it's very difficult for people to keep their attention. They want something new and different all the time. So I do try and tend to not concentrate on one project for too long. I kind of interchange things. There's a couple of reasons for that. For one, I know audience attention is just not going to be there if I do 5 or 10 videos on my clock project, showing you each and every intricate step. So I tend to try and do a fair bit off camera, so that when it comes back on camera, there's a nice big change, because often people now just don't even want to see all the bits in between. There are folks who do want to, and I prefer doing that, but things have changed. Also, it can be a challenge for me, because I'm not an electronics fundy, to say, for instance, I'm staring at like multiple projects behind you and around me. And like, for instance, my clock project, I mean, you know, I use the stepper motor to actually get the clock to move to for the analog clock to be a working project. And that's a miracle it worked, but it's not the best way of doing it. I've since gone and looked up a nice way of doing it with an Arduino, sending pulses from our Arduino to a quartz mechanism and driving it that way. And that's a far better way of doing it, but that's going to take me a fair amount of time and fiddly work to get working. It could take me 2 or 3 days, it could take me 2 weeks. And I don't really have that time to spend just on one piece of work when you're trying to push out 4 videos a month, let's say. And that's the kind of, say, the one challenge when you've got a sponsor and you're trying to bring an income in, you're trying to get those videos out. 4 videos a month isn't a high volume, but for me, when you're having to do a fair bit of intricate work to produce some of those videos, it does become a challenge. So I end up with multiple unfinished projects, which is really frustrating, but it's c'est la vie. It's just the way things work out. And that's why today I was like, on my bench, I've got like 2 or 3 things, 2 different filming projects on my bench. And I'm like, I start one and then realize, no, now I've got to do another one, which can be interesting. But then, as I say, I'm now sitting with this big mirrored thing, and it's like, now, so which video do I do to kind of keep people's attention? Because, so let me now go back into this whole thing about keeping people's attention. You may find this fascinating. I don't know whether you won't potentially consciously have realized this, perhaps, unless it's been pointed out to you. I certainly, even now, unless it had been pointed out to me when I was in, so Standard 4 would be grade 6, right, in South Africa. So in grade 6, Standard 4, this teacher said to me, I think it was an English teacher, and I can remember him standing in front of the classroom one day, and he was frustrated because he wasn't getting the attention of the 30 students that were in front of him. Now, back in those days, you could apply a bit more discipline. I pity teachers these days and the challenges of being a teacher trying to retain pupils' attention, because they've got so many devices and their attention span is very short. and their attention span is very short, and discipline is a challenge. How do you dish out discipline where it's not getting any marks these days? But he said, when he kind of stopped the class and said, you know what? He said, I know now why I'm struggling to keep your attention. And this was in the 70s. How old would I have been? At my late 70s. Yeah, probably late 70s, just stepping into the 80s in South Africa. Television had only been brought out, and I stand to be corrected, it was either 1975 or 1976 in South Africa. I'll put a footnote here if I've got it wrong. But we hadn't had television for a long time. And he had noticed that since television had kind of started up and kids were obviously now exposed to this new media in South Africa, that their attention span was diminishing, even back then. And he said, I know why. You know, up until that point in time, kids for their entertainment would perhaps have to read a book or listen to the radio. You're perhaps listening to one of those radio audio stories which goes on for half an hour, an hour. So you're used to giving something a fair bit of your attention if you're going to get something out of it. And he said, he noted that basically at that point in time, back in the 70s, early 80s, he said, you watch television tonight, and he said, count how many seconds there are between a scene change or a camera change. Now, I want to define this because it gets quite interesting when you come back to modern day. A scene change could be literally you've got the camera here and then suddenly it flicks to a totally different scene. It could be a gentle pan of the camera, so you're moving and that keeps your brain interested. It could be a gentle zoom, and you'll note if you watch people's videos and they're showing stills in a YouTube video, if they're clever, and I certainly don't this, they'll do a very slow zoom. So the brain gets more occupied and it keeps your attention looking at the still picture. You can pan, zoom, move the camera, and the most annoying one, which is in recent years, and I don't know whether you've noticed this or not, is where now you'll have, this could be in music videos, it could be even in, not documentaries, but programs or a film TV series, is the bobbing camera, right? So you've got a scene of two people talking, and as opposed to the camera being still and watching them, it's doing one of these. They're like moving the camera. It drives me insane. But this is what they do to keep the brain occupied and busy to keep the viewer's attention. So let's go back again to the late 70s, 80s, and how many seconds, and I will ask you to post down in the comments before I state, how many seconds would you get of a totally still picture with nothing going on, where there's no zooming, no panning, no camera movement, no complete scene change? How many seconds between, we'll call it scene changes? Post your comments below. Take a guess back then. So here's the answer, 10 seconds. Now when I heard this, I thought, what? Only 10 seconds? I can't believe that. And I went home and I watched TV program after TV program, and I tried to count to 10. And you might just hit 10. In some odd instances, you might hit 11 or 12, but on average, around 10 seconds, there's always a change, because then now you distract the brain potentially. Well, at that point, I presume they realize to keep people's attention, this changing the scene does it. How many seconds do you think that is now, these days? So I'll give you another chance. Go down in the comments below and post today. And this is not recent. I know now for the last 10, 15, probably even 20 years, it's changed to this period. How many seconds are there where you have a dead still camera just looking at one scene? Like you are like you are right now. I'm not doing any panning or tilting or anything with the camera. I'm not inserting what I tend to do, right, to try and keep your attention. If I'm talking about something, I'll insert pictures. There might be the odd comment, but I try and insert things. If I'm talking about a product or the driveway and the bears, I do that because I know it's going to kind of keep people's interest and attention. So here's the number, 3 seconds. I challenge you, watch a film. Watch a documentary. You'd think documentaries are better, but watch a documentary. Watch adverts. See how long they can keep the camera dead still. No panning, no zooming, no moving. Try and count to three. One Mississippi, two Mississippi, three Mississippi. You'll be surprised to get past three or four. On the whole, that's the problem now. As people and children, all of us, I sit in front of the TV with my wife, and often because I don't have time during the day to do research. Now when I say I don't have time to do my research, it's not a chore. I love the research side of my channel. But I end up doing that while I'm sitting watching TV. I've got my tablet on my lap. I'm watching TV, unless there's something, a program or something I'm really engrossed in. My attention is like here and there. I'm busy researching something, checking stuff out till late, early hours of the morning. I kind of get up later in the day, but I go to bed late. And that's what we've become. There are so many distractions and our attention is so short. So I'd be intrigued. If you've gone and posted comments below and you didn't realize this, I'd be keen to know whether you realized how short the period is in terms of keeping people's attention on a camera. And you'll see YouTubers are adopting this. As I said, I certainly do, not to any extreme. Years ago, I started doing inserts instead of just talking like I am now, absolutely nothing, because it bores people to tears for the most part. And of course, the challenge is, I'm going to ask at the video how many people have got to the end. But if you watch other YouTubers' videos, what they do to keep people's attention, they... Now, I shouldn't, there are some great YouTubers who have great personalities, they're humorous. Not me, I'm fairly dry. They're humorous and they just know how to put on a good production and a good show. You know, there are some folks who are, I'd consider, fairly dry. Alex on Autos, I love watching his channel, right? His production quality, the way he reviews vehicles, I love that. Techmoan, what a good gent, English gent. He's been doing videos for years, started reviewing cameras and what have you. He does no major bling blang. He's just got excellent production quality. And I really respect those guys for sticking it the way what they've done and the work they put into producing their videos. You then get the YouTubers who it's all about making flashbangs, things go wrong. And YouTubers have also just had to adopt this approach of fast scene changes, moving cameras, panning, and all this kind of trickery. So yeah, it's a challenge. And the silly thing is, as much as I don't subscribe to that, I do need to be aware and conscious of it when I do my videos. Because I know although I'm not looking to really grow my audience now or gain huge amounts of views, much to my sponsors' frustration, I think. I told them up front. They used to tell me, oh, Martin, do this and share it here and do these tags to increase the number of views. And I'm like, no, that's not what I do anymore. If you're not happy with my current viewership, then go elsewhere, you know. But yeah, it's a challenge for me sometimes when I'm trying to pick a project. I sometimes put things aside because I just know it's not going to be that exciting enough to keep a reasonable amount of people watching. And I kind of still need to keep a reasonable amount of people watching. But but yeah, I certainly, I'm not subscribing to the normal games that most folks have to do in terms of keeping audience attention. But anyway, I thought I'd just post this fun one. I'd be intrigued to see how many people do reach this point where we're at the end of the video. I think I've got some interesting stuff that I could just do vlogs about, where I'm just sitting and talking. Most of you don't know my work background or what I've done in my past. What I'm doing in my videos is I'm doing videos about things I have basically very little experience and knowledge on. I have to do a fair bit of work to produce the videos I do. I come from an IT background. I did IT consulting for 20 years, the first 20 years of my career before switching to this. So in theory, you know, if I was to talk about computer networking, from going from mainframes to Windows Network, Novell Networks, Windows Networks, hacking. I used to do a bit of intruder or penetration testing, hacking, white hat hacking, back in the day. So those things I could talk about with far more authority and knowledge because I did that for a long time. But I've chosen a path where I do things where I'm intrigued about learning more. I love learning about technology and what have you, and that's why I do the videos I do. But anyway, if you at the end of this video and you don't mind the odd video blog like this, where I go back and perhaps talk about some of my past experiences, and I've got some interesting anecdotal stories from my IT past. I worked for some fairly big corporates with running fairly big IT infrastructure and networks. I've got some fascinating stories about trying to get servers up and running in the middle of the night so that hundreds of people could start their day the next day, literally running with servers and disks in our hands to plug them in at 6 o'clock in the morning because they knew the chairman was coming in and all that kind of thing. I don't know whether that kind of content would be of interest. I know it's not going to be of interest for the masses, but anyway, I thought I'd put it out there, and I will catch you soon for the next video, which is either going to be me putting together my solar test bed over here, where I'm going to show you the right mess I've got on the bench and how I try and clear it up and set it up and do some calibration testing with the sun outside, or I'll be working on showing you how to do, or how I think I'm going to do noise measurements on DC supplies. But anyway, thanks very much for watching. I'll catch you soon for the next one. Cheers.